let me know at the end of the stream. That'd be great, because I'm going to put that stream back up when we begin. But let's get this underway. All right. 3, 2, 1. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Saturday SmackDown. This is a best of 7 series between King of Osmane and Optimus Prime. It's going to be a good one. Do you like giant robots? We made that joke before, but sadly, you're not going to be able to hear it. This is the second attempt at it. It's not nearly as funny, but never mind. We do have, of course, a best of 7. Actually, perhaps a best of 5 for you today due to time constraints and things like that. I do love the war on this map. This is my favorite version of this map, actually. Kamchatka is one of Gaia's masterpieces, I think. Yeah. I really, really love this dynamic and just everything about it, how accurate it is, and just, you know, that region of Russia. That's great.
It was like one of his first maps as well, right?
Yeah, I think, yeah, it was. And I think, like, because it was one of his first ones, it was, like, this very clearly defined idea he had in his mind, possibly. Mm-hmm. I don't know, I just really love this particular spawn, the summer spawn of this map. The winter one, I don't like as much, probably because of the ice. Just removes the dynamic, and I actually think icy maps are just less interesting to look at as well. But we do have a game in front of us, don't we, Zuda? This is King of Osmane here in the south of the map, and the color green playing is indeed the British, slamming down, by the looks of it, 2 manor houses from the get-go there with his 300 wood star. His opponent to the north here looks like he's going to be picking up a small monkey there, nice treasure, and he has come across no sheep just yet, but in his base has done the same thing by the looks of it. 2 manor houses as well. We do have a British mirror. No trading post shenanigans, no market tree, or anything like that.
Which is going to make the goats even more impactful, right? I'm glad you brought up that point, that he hadn't run into any goats yet, because, like you mentioned, this is a map and a matchup, Brit Mirrors, where trading posts are not as important as they are in other matchups. The very TP standard meta right now is not really affecting the British civilization. And as a result of that, I don't think we'll see too much TP action. If we get late enough into Age 2 where players have the extra resources to begin to continue to like improve, like that, you know, that's step 4 or 5 down the road. But the first thing's get your 700 wood, get your mana boom going, take control of the map, make sure you secure the hunts. And TPs don't really have too much impact in that nature. So it will be important to see how many goats each player picks up, because that is going to be a pretty nice little boost to food. And currently it's 5-1, which is pretty nice advantage for King of Osmane.
Yeah, that's hugely in King of Osmane's favor. I'm going to switch over to the economy tab, which you're clearly already on and looking at. I do like this. Another shout out. I mentioned Gaia's maps almost every time we start. And, well, not almost every, but the point is I mentioned them a lot, but ASAMP's UI is also something that really needs to be shouted out there. I don't think that gets done nearly as much. SmackDown and certainly the tournament games would not be to the high quality that we all hopefully know and love today. Would be definitely very archaic, like the old days. This thing is done so much, so thank you to ASAMP there for that. But back in the game, I suppose, trading posts, a lack of them is all green goat gonna get caught by the Red Explorer.
Uh-oh. Delete it! Oh, maybe they don't go to see it. Just, nope, there
it is. It does go over the red. I felt like that goat just transformed and then, like, and I, like, what? I thought, what? King of Osmane rage quit?
lost the goat, lost the game. I'm out, GG.
So British doesn't see very much play in the tournament, and, you know, you said that was surprising. I think that's surprising. Yeah. British are a very strong civilization, and, you know, definitely something that was seen a lot during some of the previous tournaments.
Yeah.
But since trading posts, you know, are so, you know, you mentioned this trading post meta, right? British doesn't rely on trading posts, doesn't need them, so still an excellent choice on perhaps maps that do not have trading posts.
Yeah.
But do you think overall British has just become less good in terms of its power level compared to other civilizations, because, you know, lots of other civilizations can make use of those trading posts, whereas, you know, civilizations like Dutch, which use all of their wood on banks, and British on manors, and maybe even Japan on shrines. You know, civilizations that don't use those trading posts, are they perhaps weaker now?
Yeah. two things. I want to follow up your point, because you're making some very good points, but look what we have brewing here in the middle of the map. Kind of an interesting little dynamic going on here with both players setting up shop in the middle. But yes, like you mentioned, the TP meta is very strong right now, and as a result, because Brits don't benefit from that TP meta, the civs that do benefit from
his hand combat in the ville. I was hoping he would. I really, really wanted to see it. Will it go down? There's 2 villages here now, and
it's a 2v2 battle.
Yeah.
And the explorers are both like the same. The explorers are at like the same HP as well. They're within 7, so.
God, I'd hate to live in those houses there. the rivalry from across the road. Perhaps this is the start of a nasty street, but Outpost Wagon incoming.
Yeah, both, and I would not be surprised at all to see like dueling Outpost Wagons here in the middle of the map as well. Where did the red villager? Oh, there we go. Okay, the red player is going to back it off a little bit.
Plan a bit more defensive there. Yeah. I mean, that barracks is basically fully upright, and that batch of Musk is going to come out first, quite a lot faster. And I'm not sure if he was up to the Colonial Age faster, but you know, a military unit shipment perhaps. Though unlikely, because of course you'd be much more wanting to send the wood.
Was up 6 seconds earlier, so
not really very relevant at all. But since the barracks was up so much sooner, right, musketeers come out, and then suddenly that Brax is threatened, and all this can be quite... Yeah. But is that villager going to go down? Wow.
Yeah, he's getting a little bit low. I think he should be okay. He can always hide in the outpost. And do remember that the outpost is helping DPS down the British Explorer, or the Red Explorer, I guess. They're both British, so... should be okay. It looks like he's going to save it. First match of muskets pops out, and he does go down. One other thing I wanted to point out, I actually kind of like this positioning of the outpost that King of... or that Optimus Prime has put down. If we take into consideration what it does, one, it covers this choke point quite well. It still gives him vision of any units coming through there. But it also is not in a position that's exactly trivial to see a Dreadnought. In order to get to it, you have to kind of come around this bend. And then it has less surface area because it is hugged right up next close to that little piece of water. So it's kind of in an awkward position for the green player to siege. And it looks like as a result, we're just going to see him coming over the other gap over here and try and start up some of his musket pressure.
Yeah, I like that placement as well. Yeah, absolutely. As you walk around, it's just, and it shoots from across the river. Really nice. Less surface area, as you mentioned. I wanted to, whilst we've got a little bit of a lull here waiting for things to happen, of course, 700 wood and 600 wood coming out of the green player here, by the looks of it, going to get all the XP out of the manors and slam the manors down for the villagers, and all of that XP, of course, will aid his shipment progression. Wants to values the wood over the villager shipment, over the 5 villager shipment, even though that is, you know, perhaps better in terms of economy. This does get the shipments rolling. That's the point of this, I suppose. And of course, the red player doing the same. So this is happening, and I'm sure for the time being, muskets will continue to be trained. Perhaps we'll see more military buildings added in, but should we finish talking about the trading post thing we sort of started out? Oh,
explorer. Stand up, sit down.
Executed.
Stands up and gets set right back down. But yes, what were you saying? I was only half listening because I was too busy watching that explorer get shot in the back.
Destroyed. Yeah. Something the trading post points we mentioned.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So, I mean, the civs that are really, really good, currently Germany, French especially, are really good because of the trading post. And the one thing that Britain needs, in addition to, I mean, the lack of the trading post being in their advantage when it is a non-TP map, but Brits are very, very hunt-dependent. They need so many hunts in order to make their boom actually worthwhile, whereas a civilization like Japan doesn't need the explicit hunt, right? They can shrine the hunt, which is good, but they don't have to be able to have tons of hunts to eat. And so Brits is kind of unique in the fact that one, they're good on non-TP high hunt maps, which there actually aren't a ton of. If you think of the non-TP maps, maps like Bengal and maps like Cascade Range, they're actually fairly low hunt, and the hunt is fairly poor. And so those two maps, they would be very good on should the hunt be a little bit higher, but unfortunately the hunt's not very high. And as a result, I think they kind of struggle as a result of that. So I think they're kind of a niche pick on some maps, but unfortunately the maps...
Oh, Explorer's going to get executed again.
He keeps standing.
Poor guy, poor Henry Oxley.
If you think about it, though, that's a fairly good amount of XP, like Optimus Prime mentioning it as well.
It's that red house, isn't it, that makes him keep standing up.
Exactly.
If there's something nearby when it gets to 100 HP, it regenerates over time. It just... farm.
It is an XP farm. This is actually kind of nice.
This goes back to my Minecraft days where you spawn mobs in the dark. And anyway, at this point, the game is actually fairly stale here. Now going to siege down that house. Is that the right decision, considering you're getting so much free XP out of the Explorer? Or maybe he just wants the extra XP now and it's time to push and 54 XP is going to be useful or something like that. But plenty of muskets here. Now going to start pushing into his opponent. Does that mean perhaps his next shipment is going to be something like musketeer attack? There it is. It does come out, and it looks like it's go time for the green player there. Let's switch on over to the military units tab. have and see what they have here. It's 44 green muskets with the upgrade versus 39 that do not have it. Red sees it as well. Looks like he's going to kite backwards, get out of range, and takes a few more shots on the retreat there. Let's take a look at the units in queue. He's going to need to pop a batch of 10 in his Minutemen to hold this, I would imagine.
Yeah, and looks he like also needs his, he needs his card to come as well. He needs his corresponding musket attack card to come. If Fortville comes right now, it might just be game over.
He might be able to pick off a few muskets here whilst Green's sieging. No Green, good control. They're not going to randomly siege down that tower whilst he's taking damage here. But this is, I guess, so many muskets in the back not dealing damage, whereas Green, I think he's got a good sort of line of fire. He's got good volleys coming off, whereas a lot of these red ones haven't been shooting.
He does have the tower DPS, though, adding in, which is going to start to add up the longer this, prolonged fight goes here. It looks like Green originally got into a slightly better position as well with his units. His reinforcement time is a little bit longer, but it looks like it's not going to matter. Two batches coming in from either side, and I think he should be able to clean this up. Also worth noting that he is slightly ahead in terms of just overall shipment progression because of the extra XP he's had. So the longer this extended fight goes on underneath this location, we have to assume his musket HP card is going to be becoming significantly quicker as well, which may be impactful here in the next minute or so.
So I'm wondering where Red didn't manage to get quite as many units in. There's a card. What is this one? Yeah, defense coming in, so really quite far ahead now. This is going to be tough for the red player. But why doesn't he have quite as many muskets? I'm looking at it. It does call his Minutemen there. They're going to join the fight, and they're going to be really useful here. I think the only thing saving Red, really, is the fact that his units are being reinforced much more quickly than Green's, and hopefully that will become relevant for him. But Red, by the looks of it, he's researched Amalgamation, he's researched Greatcoats, he's spent extra resources that Green hasn't. Does that... how much do you think that contributes to having less muskets here? Because clearly this game... defined by the number of muskets that were able to be produced, and that comes down, of course, to the macro and the tech decisions that you made earlier in the game.
Yeah, I don't know that it is somewhat impactful. I mean, Amalgamation is 400 resources that you're not going to get back, and I do think that 7 minutes and 27 seconds is too early to get it, especially when you're producing muskets only. But it has kind of a two-way effect. One, you're spending 200 food, but also the 200 wood means less houses, less villagers coming in. It is slightly impactful, but I think realistically the more important thing was the unit positioning. The fact that King of Osmin got off a couple of decent volleys when he had an upgrade advantage. And then once he gets into a better position and he kind of starts that snowball running, gets, even a couple of muskets ahead, things start to snowball. His next shipment comes a little bit earlier. He gets the HP card in that much quicker. And then it's just really difficult to make a recovery. It's very similar in a Japan mirror like that. Once you start falling behind in the musket count, it gets very difficult to keep back up. If you can make some sort of a neat little transition with, a mixed batch of longbows or something like that, perhaps there's a chance. But if you get behind in the musket wars and continue just to try and fight it out with muskets, something like this eventually ends up happening. And King of Osmin takes game number one as a result.
He does. Contributing factors being, of course, the macro, as we mentioned, but also Green's concave. I saw that being mentioned in a chat. That's a really nice way to describe it, actually. So. Being able to get his muskets to do more damage and actually shoot much more quickly. And as a result, that is the end of the game. So, as you... let's just get into the next one.
Brit mirrors are very similar to Japan mirrors these days, where it's like, you just kind of fight with muskets, except there's not like the house sieging.
That's the nice thing about the Japan, that dynamic. What am I looking at? Camtasia Studios, open, new, folder... Osmin vs. Robot.
Robot man. Robot pew pew pew.
Capture one. Alright, now it's going to load up the editing suite that I don't want right now. God, I wish I was there yesterday, damn it.
You're still disappointed about missing out on Hitler.
Yeah, I'm disappointed about missing out on Hitler. For those of you that are wondering what on earth we're talking about, it's a board game.
We played last night, and Zuda Zuda got Hitler twice in a row and managed to convert to victories with...
Did you? Wow.
With his Chancellor Maito twice in a row. Twice in a row, me and Maito got the same roles. We got
testing.
Hitler and Fascist.
Okay, everything's good. Sorry, I thought for a moment that... my voice wasn't being recorded, so I just shouted the word testing. Yeah, I've played Hitler 3 times in a row. That's my record. And I don't remember the outcome of those games.
It's so fun being Hitler. Because you get to, like, you get to be so deceptive. Yeah, you get to be so deceptive. And just watching the world crumble in front of you is so pleasing. He's hosted, by the way.
Oh, King of Oz main spiel.
The Spieler. Schnickerspieler.
Meine Damen und Herren.
You've got it down a little bit better now. You've been practicing.
Well, that's the only bit I remember.
Okay.
Which is, I think, ladies and gentlemen.
Right. Meinen...
Or willkommen. I think that's welcome.
Yeah, because meinen, it would be like my ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah. My men and women, something like that.
Sure.
But probably ladies and gentlemen. It makes me wonder, is ladies might be, I'm not sure if that's an English word or if it was from French origin. That's not the point right now. They're going off on a linguistic adventure.
Going off on an adventure. Are you basically like Bilbo Baggins? You're just going on an adventure.
There and back again.
Yeah.
What do you think of those movies?
The Hobbit movies specifically?
Yeah, I've heard mixed reviews.
They took a book that's like a 270-page book and tried to stretch it into 10 hours of film. You can read the entire novel quicker than you can watch the entire film series.
So much of those movies is completely made up. I was tempted to say is complete fiction, but then, hold on a moment, isn't the entire thing fiction?
Yeah, I mean, it should have been like 1 3-hour movie is what it should have been.
Yeah.
If it would have been 1 3-hour movie, they could have skipped so much of the like BS that doesn't matter in that movie, and like the long. I mean, so much of what Peter Jackson does in film is he loves to do like aerial shots of people walking across mountains, basically. And if some of that's okay, it's okay to appreciate the beauty that's New Zealand and to just like, you know, see some of those nice shots. But we don't need 3 hours of it stretched out over the course of, you know, a 10-hour film festival, right? Like
maybe it was a cash grab, you know. Lord of the Rings, very successful. Peter Jackson, known to be an excellent director of those movies.
Yeah.
I think Lord of the Rings might actually, if you ask what my favorite movie is, I might actually put Lord of the Rings in the nominees group.
Yeah. I'm
not saying it's my favorite movie, but out of all of the movies that I've been able to recall during this period of time from when we first posed the question, Lord of the Rings does go into the nominees.
Yeah, and I mean, Lord of the Rings is also like 1,000 pages of a novel, right? It's much longer. There's much more plot there. There's multiple different storylines, right? Because you've got like when the Fellowship like breaks and Frodo and Sam go and do their thing and the rest of the Fellowship are doing other things, right? You have like different things going on, like different plots and different storylines, but The Hobbit is like one small group and they go to a mountain and they try and kill a dragon. Like we don't need more spoilers, by the way, if you haven't read The Hobbit or seen The Hobbit.
Yeah. You know, I'm more okay with spoiling films than I am with TV series.
Yeah. Well, plus, like, I mean, The Hobbit is a book that came out in like 1954. Like,
yeah, I think that's okay.
Spoiling something that's 60 or 70 years old is probably fair as well.
There's not much to spoil either. It's like Bilbo, bunch of dwarves turn up at his house, heads out into the wild.
Tries to kill a dragon.
They meet a bunch of things on the way. The guy he's with goes crazy. The guy he's with works out what team he's on again. I think he dies, and then they will go home.
Yep, that's basically it.
But what really strikes me is, like, The Lord of the Rings is actually only set a couple years after, you know, still within the same lifetime of Bilbo, right?
Yep.
What the fuck happened to that giant mountain with thousands of tons of gold under it? Like,
who got all
surely that? Why is that not? Surely that's like it should be still a contentious point.
I'm pretty sure it, like, the dwarves get it back, right? Because it was, like, their original home and they had gotten it. So I'm pretty sure, like, it belonged to the dwarves all along. Like, they get it back.
Yeah, I think, like, I don't think they got to keep all the gold, though. Did they get it back? Well,
All right.
I don't know. Like, there'll be some guy in the chat that knows everything about Lord of the Rings.
Hopefully so.
Hair out. It's like, interjection, of course! The gold was distributed among all of the various kingdoms.
The seven founding fathers, yeah.
I don't know. All right, let me, oh, for fuck's sake, green.
But he did click in briefly, and then he unclicked in.
Thanks, old man.
I wonder what this taunt 100 is that he keeps dropping in chat.
Yeah. Zuya, do you want to do a taunt pack with me? You and I can record, like, 30 new taunts.
Yeah, that would be great. One of them can be, like, absolutely, and stuff like that.
Instead of taunt 1 becomes absolutely.
Yeah, that would be great.
Mama Smurf whispered me and says the gold was distributed between the fighters after the war. So basically every nation.
Everyone gets a little chunk of that gold.
Yeah.
All
right.
Fair enough. Oh.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Snap. Never mind.
He's struggling to decide whether or not he should stay. There we go.
You know what? I'm not even going to. Yes, I am going to record this. All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to game number 2 in this best of 7 series. This is
a
best of 5 series, and it's game number 2, actually. Never mind. I'm going to do the intro again because we're not even on the map. Alright, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to game number 2 in this best of 5 series between Optimus Prime, and King of Oz Main. The map is...
Arkansas.
Alright, I know this. One other one of Gaia's maps. Alright, here we do have King of Oz Main. Oh my god, I tabbed out and now it's deafening.
Uh-oh.
So how about you continue from where I left?
Where you are. Alright, spawning on the right side of the map. Playing the French civilization in the color green is King of Oz Main. And his opponent today...
What is shooting so much? I just hear constant gunfire.
It's
still going.
It's the Renegado, I would
assume. Oh, is that guy over there? Alright.
Yeah. Spawning on the left side of the map, in the color red, is Optimus _Prime. Just get your sounds worked out.
Yeah, I did.
Alright, sweet.
Optimus Prime, starting with the market there. Leaving his coin on the floor, of course, does not need that. Not going to help him age up any quicker. Though, having said that, I actually probably will gather it. No, he's got 50 coin. What was he doing with that? He could gather that up and then just buy his... But wait, what treasures did he find? I guess... 80 food? 90 coin?
Which guy are we looking at?
Well,
King of Oz Main?
We're looking at the King of Oz Main there.
Yeah,
he's
got 80 food.
He's going to leave his coin on the floor. He's chosen to do that. Could have collected that and buy some wood, but a coin still available to him there. The red player has done the same, left his coin on the floor, but he's actually playing Russia and is not going to be using that, and that certainly will not be of any use to him for the time being here. That is the matchup, Russia versus France, the vanilla matchup on what is actually... a fairly short rush distance map, and I think the hunts do favor the Russian player here.
Yeah, I think this is actually a really interesting map for this matchup because so often, right, Russia relies on the pressure and the ability to create quite a bit of pressure in their opponent's face to control the map, just keep them in age 2, and not allow them to get aged up and get to age 3, where, you know, Russia starts having issues with dragoons and skirms and stuff like that. And this is a good map, like you mentioned. If we take off the fog briefly to look at French's hunt, right? I mean, he's got this hunt down here to the south, which is pretty good. He's got this hunt up here to the north, which is also pretty good. But there's not a ton of room behind his base for him to backpedal. There's not a big safe hunt behind his base. And then when he starts getting out into this area of the map, this is going to be contestable due to the fact that Russia is quite likely going to have an aggressive blockhouse and be trying to put some pressure on this hunting location. And then from there, I mean, if you start looking at hunts number 3, 4, 5, I mean, they're plentiful, but they're pretty far out, right? So definitely something that Russia can look to make an advantage of. And here we see already two villagers stepping their way forwards. Let's see how aggressive the blockhouse ends up getting. I wouldn't be too surprised to see it very aggressively placed.
Yeah, absolutely, though. Don't want to get too close. If it is scouted, of course, which is quite likely considering the green scout here. He is the Witchica scout. If he does find the blockhouse, then it is too close to your opponent's base. Minutemen can be called, and he has the coin. He has the coin available to send those Minutemen. And can shoot the villagers, and at that point they basically pay for themselves. Where is this villager going? They're going to have one hell of a blockhouse place.
Yeah, we've got two villagers coming down. This guy, I wonder if he got spotted and he just wanted to try and split them up to confuse the opponent.
Yeah, that's possible. Yeah, absolutely. Thing is, though, he's just going to gather coin out over here. Right? makes me wonder where this Rex placement is going to be. Yeah, but absolutely, going to be aggressive, going to be very far forward, going to be pushing the French player, forcing him to deal with the pressure so that he can continue to hunt. We'll have to see where that goes.
Yeah, he ended up dropping down a market behind this and started researching. There it goes, hunting dogs. So, kind of actually interesting here. It looks like he's kind of aborted his plan of any sort of blockhouse. He's gotten both these villagers now starting to wander down here to the south side of the map.
Yep.
Maybe he'll end up dropping down like a hidden stable or something. There could be a chance he's going to do something like really tricky or try and do something tricky like proxy a Prichnik rush or something like that. I think it could be interesting to see.
I think it was the next level meta where you try to bait opponents.
I'm telling you, it's proxy of Prichnik Rush. The thing is, I don't even know that it's bad. I'm not even convinced it's bad.
Well, it must be terrible if they have... Well, against somebody semi-FFing...
Exactly, right? Like, yeah, your opponent's going to have, like... 5 Hussar, what happens if you just ship 6 Aprichniks, make like 10, you just run into your opponent's base with 16 Aprichniks while he's semi-FFing and only has 5 Hussar, just siege down his TC and kill every single one of his bills.
Yeah, I'd love to see it. But I was going to mention, 700 coin does come out from him. Does look like this is going to be a fast fortress. Almost has the 300 gold that he needs to click up, and plus that 700 is 1,000. And going to be gathering almost nothing but food. Is that true?
Yeah.
I mean, a couple distributed, and I'm sure they'll all move over to food sooner or later. But I think that's it. He's certainly going to be going up to the fortress age. And with this proxy stable, Oprichnik's definitely on the cards. Could be the case. And I don't think that's been scouted with, though, certainly.
He's got Cossacks in queue. He's got Cossacks in queue. Okay, maybe he'll like semi-FF behind it or something.
5 Cossacks, semi-FF, Oprichnik. I don't know. Anyway, I was going to say, perhaps the villagers were coming really far forward. It was some sort of next level bait. Ooh, baiting the Minutemen, that is. You know, trying to call the Minutemen out. Something really strange like that. But 3 Cav do not get engaged. It looks like they are going to turn around there, which... Right.
A little bit of an engagement. One of the Cossacks does drop down, but he did get a villager for the cost of it as well. He's going to lose out... on a couple of these Cossacks, but he killed a CDB and he's going to get most of these 3 Hussar down, so probably a pretty good trade for the Russian player here. As long as he gets that next Hussar, yeah, it looks like it'd be okay. Probably okay for him. Has a reinforcing batch of Cossacks coming in here. It looks like he's just going to continue to dial up the pressure with more and more Cossacks. We can see
Cossacks coming out as well. Pure Cossacks. Alright, well, it's working. I mean, you're keeping all the enemy vills belled up.
Yep.
He's not going to be out of age anytime soon because of the lack of resources that he has. Any crates that he send are going to be difficult to get in queue. He's not going to have any resources incoming for training units here. Cossacks just could just run, you know, 5 Cossacks that have been shipped, continue to train more Cossacks out of that 700 coin shipment that was sent. Keep all these vills belled up. Is he going to squeeze out a cheeky win here?
This is seeming to be actually pretty good against what his opponent... Like, look at how many Cossacks he currently has out. It's just an insane number.
There's no such thing as an 8 pikeman shipment for France.
Yeah.
Minutemen are called, and I assume once he kills off these remaining Hussar, he's going to get on out of there. Or is he just going to brute force down the Minutemen?
He can probably just stay there. He killed another 2 CDB during all of this, forced Minutemen as well. This is very awkward for French. I mean, French is in a pickle here. If you take a look at the shipment sent as well,
the rack's coming down.
He's got 4 Cossacks available as well. Like, he can continue to keep up this pretty insane cavalry mass behind us.
I'm going to take a look at the units in queue and see what we do have. More Cossacks in queue. Looks like he's also going to be laying down a blockhouse. I guess he's getting ready for the transition into Musketeers. But 3 Cav plus the Minutemen. I guess Minutemen are actually quite awkward to finish off, considering these are melee units. But once they're down, if he can stop this barracks going up, we're not going to see any Musketeers, or pikemen for that matter, come out. And Looks like French is sort of holding though at the moment.
Yeah, he's okay, but this is
and he's found the resources for two trading posts.
Yeah, at the same time though, this is okay for Russia. I mean, we always talk about what does Russia like? They like little scrappy duels and in awkward situations, trading off units, having good cost-effective trades, right? And that's exactly what this has been. Plus, at the same time, he's locking the French player into h2 play, which, if we look at, you know, what he's got going down in the middle of the map, he's securing the middle of the map with a blockhouse. He's going to have access to all of these hunts behind this blockhouse with fairly good vision. And the original points that we made about, you know, the French player having low hunts, being a little bit concerned about securing his hunts and stuff like that in the mid game is certainly going to be problematic the longer this game goes. So I actually think that Red's still in a fine spot, and it's kind of an interesting little proxy stable that has actually ended up paying off for him quite nicely so far.
Yeah, but it looks like France has managed to stabilize. He's got his 3 Hussar shipment now. He's got his racks up finally. He's got his 700 coin down, and no doubt we'll see lots of useful military units enter the battlefield from those two buildings there. And suddenly, the control of the game is no longer directly in Russia's favor. But yes, he has gotten quite a number of good trades there. But I think at this point, France, not in a bad spot. He would probably like to be heading on up to the Fortress Age, which probably was the original plan. But for the time being, is doing okay. Looks like we have a cav chase going down.
Yep, the great cav train is currently in motion. Look at the economic unit population behind this, though, as well.
Yeah, it's really good, right? Especially considering 4 and 3 set settlers have been shipped.
Yeah, I mean, not many civs, especially as Russia, you don't beat many civs in economic unit population before, you know, the 10-minute mark. You don't have a villager shipment. You don't have things like banks or shrines, something like that, right? That really improves you in that regard. And to that point, I mean, 29 to 28, 32 to 28 now, you know, as the villagers continue to come in, is perfectly fine. Especially now he's got spice trade rolling. He's got very good map control. He's got plenty of Cossacks out. He can deal with this raid, no problems. The only thing that's somewhat concerning is the fact that his opponent does have 2 trading posts and the stagecoach upgrade. So there's a little bit of unaccounted for economic unit population in that regard for Osmi.
One going down, which is a nice response to it. I like that.
But at the same time,
it does kill some villages.
Yeah, but I think he's still okay. Russia's probably fine with this. France is locked for the most part into H2 play, and that's what Russia wants. That's a huge win for him. We'll see how it ends up shaking out.
And then I just want to go back to the economic point. They're both very, very even at this point. But, you know, the longer the game goes on, that gets more and more favor of Russia, which does have faster training villages, which does have cheaper villages. And in terms of upgrades, you know, he certainly has spice trade working away for him. He has that wood trickle. Let's take a look at the text complete there. Yeah, steel traps is working away for him as well, and place of mines, whereas his opponent doesn't have place of mines. So definitely the longer this game goes, the more in favor of Red it's going to be, providing he can deal something with that trade route. But it looks like it's not going to matter too much if his army gets annihilated right here. The amount of time it would take the villagers he currently has to reproduce this army again is going to give France the time he needs to really make sure he can secure.
He had 13 Strelitz coming.
He did, and he has a couple of muskets there.
Maybe
he didn't realize he was... Okay.
Yeah, I don't think he was actually as far behind. I mean, so he's going to lose this fight here, right? But I don't know that he's really all that far behind. He did get caught out and lost some muskets, but I don't think he's.
I mean, it's not a good trade, but it's not terrible, especially with more units that are nearby. Maybe it is now French favored, because I can see French very easily securing this trading route quite easily, making sure it stays up, and then perhaps even getting the third one.
But he's also got a lot of resources behind this as well. Like, he's got a lot in bank. Like, he'll be able to... He could right now train a batch of Strelitz and drop a stable and start queuing up Cossacks, no problem.
Alright.
That was definitely an early resign, but it's fine.
I'm heading on out to the next one. I'm just going to take this jumper off. I'm, like, wearing 2 jumpers at the moment because I lost my coat somewhere and I went out early. Hold on. Kind of forgot I was wearing them.
Time to strip down, boys.
All right, I'm back. Interesting. Any updates on where we were at in the 69-hour rebroadcast? Oh, I lost my quality options. Oh.
That's somewhat disappointing, isn't it?
Ripping pepperonis. Now. Yeah, we got them like 16 hours into the stream.
I think Twitch should at any point realize if you've got the commitment to stream for 10 hours, that like you should just automatically get quality options.
Yeah, but surely like what's the point at that point? You're probably about to finish.
Well, not if you're doing a 69-hour stream.
Yeah, well, that the whole point of the YouTube stream though was to give people quality options. But now I'm gonna actually have to on that to give them quality options. That's a shame. Actually, maybe not. How many viewers do you have quality options on your stream?
Let me take a look.
Because if you do, maybe the viewers would be kind enough to just sit in the ESOP chat until we get them.
No, I don't. I don't have quality options.
Damn it. Maybe, whatever. How many viewers do you have?
Like a 150.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, pretty standard SmackDown numbers. I do want to briefly, the game is hosted, by the way. I do want to briefly mention two things. One is that there's the new event hosted by ASO-community.net, the, what's that thing called? Strong World Season 2. Is currently in the mix, so do check that out. Incog and Brandboy were telling me about that earlier. I did just want to mention that briefly because I think it is for team players, especially people who are interested in team games. I think it's a great way for them to get the option to play that. So I do think that that's kind of cool, and I just wanted to briefly make sure that I mentioned that before I forgot. And the second thing is. H2O actually put out a replay pack of all of his training games that he was doing in preparation for this tournament, a bunch of the replays of all of his tournament games, and all of that stuff as well. So I was cruising through that dump a little bit earlier, looking at all those games. And if you're looking to improve at the game, if you're looking for high-level replays to watch, do definitely pick that up as well, because that is a wealth of information from one of the current best players. If you're looking how to see, you know, how to play in the current meta, that is definitely where I would go to start watching. So check those two things out over at ESO-community.net, and you won't regret it. I guarantee it.
So the score is 2-0?
That is correct. Osmane is currently up 2-0. Let's do... What map should we do? Arizona? Let's do Arizona. I haven't seen Arizona too much recently.
Large Honshu Regicide.
large Honshu Regicide.
Why did they make large maps? Like, it just... Oh, they're so bad. Large maps are just dumb.
To you, they are. But I guarantee you there's, like, some guy who just wants to, like, play SimCity, basically, right?
Yeah, you're right. True. But I just feel like... I don't know. Like, having played Age of Empires 3, the best Age of Empires 3 games come from smaller maps where you have a lot more ability to move around, and just large maps are just silly anyway. Like, there's so many tiles between your TC and your first hunt. It's like you're walking for days.
I do agree. I prefer to play on smaller-ish maps. I'm not going to say small maps, because I actually prefer... big maps, and I prefer big maps within the small set, right? But I can, at the same time, I can see why some people, you know, like, I can see some of the appeal, especially for newer players. They just want to, like, build all the buildings and have a bunch of cool walls, and they just want some space to explore the game. I think that's understandable.
Yeah.
Are you ready?
Yeah. Can't tech, luckily. Alright, he's gonna play German.
Alright. Here we go. Let's, German is like Eero with 200 wood stat.
Is that what Dioroga said? Is that the series we were casting where that comment was made?
Yeah, Dioroga said that.
Yeah. Obviously, they're not like Eero because they play in a different style. I think he was just meaning, like, the power level of Germany is, in his opinion, on par with Iroquois on Robot Pitch. And I don't know that that's necessarily true. I think playing a strong German is much more difficult than playing a strong Eero. So.
All right, well, let's get this one underway. King of Osmane versus the Robot.
Robot Man.
Game number 3 in this best of 5 on Arizona, which uses the Painted Desert picture set and tile set. And kind of looks like, I don't know, if you're like standing maybe 10 meters away from your monitor and you look at this screen, you'd be like, what on earth is that? I'm not actually sure if the terrain would, does it look like this in Arizona? Surely not.
I don't think it does. Like, I think
it's extremely pink.
It almost looks like a lunar landing or something, right? Like. I don't think it's probably quite like this.
It's like a watercolor painting. If you turn, like, just go ahead and do it right now. But if you turn off the graphics down to minimum, or just...
Yeah, well, I do have it on minimum because I'm on my old computer, right? And so it does look like a lunar landscape, basically.
It just looks hilarious. Yeah. Like, it's so bad. Because if you turn max graphics on, you get little shrubs everywhere, which is kind of...
And then it makes it look a little bit more normal.
Yeah, you can see what they're aiming for. But yeah, Germany in the south of the map in the color red. Looks like he's going to be slamming down that trading post there on the far left-hand corner. I'm not sure what the crate starts were. Looks like it was a 300 wood start.
Yeah, it must have been a 200 wood start for Germans.
Yeah. Otherwise, you can't get a trading post. What am I talking about? Yep. Yeah, and of course, Aztec also has his markets and his fire pit and, of course, his house there. Not going to be going with the trading post. That's been something, a popular alternative to perhaps...
Ooh, he just got that passive XP as well. Very, very close.
I wasn't looking.
It was very close. He just barely got it. Like, he finished pounding it up and the cart went by, like, synchronously. It's very close.
Yeah. But he's going to pick himself up 75 coin by the looks of it. His opponent does pick up 60 food. So both players off to a nice start there. Let's take a look at their age ones.
Yeah. One thing that I wanted to point out, because I've been watching... I've been studying Garja Aztec a little bit. And one thing that I noticed, Garja does now on 300 wood starts with Aztec, which I actually think is pretty intelligent, is he takes his explorer, he builds the TP in the house, he doesn't build the fire pit, and then he uses his warrior priest in age 1 to help support his monk in treasure gathering. And it is a priest, right? And it heals fairly quickly. So you can take treasures and then heal yourself up. You can use it in combat to help aid you in taking various treasures, stuff like that, right? So I think it's actually pretty good. The fact that you can like run around with that and use it to not only help you take treasures but keep your monk high HP. And then when he starts to transition into age 2, gets a 700 wood, builds the fire pit, and then kicks him back home. And then you start dancing with him there for the XP, and then you get the 3x the 3 warrior chief war priest coming in behind that as well. And so then that whole shenanigans with the warrior priest and the fire pits starts to ramp up. But I actually thought it was a kind of a smart adaptation for Aztec in general with like the TP meta to allow them to get a trading post and still make use of warrior priest going into age 2.
Yeah, I like that. Guys, Aztec guide in the chat, please.
Yeah, maybe we need a revamp to the Aztec guide, because I don't think the Garja guide specifically lists that out as a possible strategic option anywhere.
Maybe he needs to update that then.
Yeah. No.
Let's see. But that's not what's happened here, but it's definitely interesting to think about. But I don't know what to say. Aztec versus German.
Yeah. So, I mean, if we think about the matchup a little bit, right? I mean, both sides are almost finishing aging. In fact, Optimus Prime, the Aztec player, is just finishing aging now with a fairly standard 15 pop fast age up. And we'll see what he ends up doing as a result of that. I don't see any villagers moving forward just yet. And we watched this particular matchup, actually, in the semifinals between Dairaga and H2O. They ended up playing this exact matchup, and Dairaga played fairly aggressively, trying to force the German player to stay in the second age. And he did so with some success early on, but then he was afraid of overcommitting into like Minuteman, a crossbow shipment, maybe some Ulan, stuff like that. And then so he ended up staying a little bit too far back. Germany ended up getting aged out and then just kind of slow rolled him with a push out. Optimus Prime taking a slightly different approach. We can see three Warrior Priests coming as his first card in the second age. Just going to be trying to play it. It looks like an economic step. Though.
That is the question.
Oh, man. It's actually really close. In fact, I think the Aztec War Chief might just die.
Oh, wow. That would actually be...
Yeah. I'm pretty sure he's just
I think
down.
It will.
In fact, I think it maybe would have been intelligent for Optimus Prime to abandon trying to kill...
I think that's what he's... Okay, wow. Maybe... He should have kept. Yeah.
I think Optimus should have just churned on the Green Explorer because he's really low. He's got these two Outlaw Riders. He could have probably killed the Green Explorer and then still finished killing the treasure as well.
Yeah, but that is the result of that. By the looks of it, Explorer does go down and doesn't get the treasure. But Blue, yeah, up with three Warrior Priests as you mentioned and Fencing School.
Wow.
Well, that's okay. A card. I'm not quite sure what he's going to do with that, except train his inventory much more quickly, I suppose. And by the looks of it, that's exactly what he's going to be doing from of course, this War Hut. Makes me wonder why it's been sent. Does he have the economy to sustain to make use of it fully? And surely, always building a second War Hut is perhaps the better decision, right, than sending this, which is effectively a second War Hut at this early point in the game. It makes me wonder... What he has in mind with this shipment.
I'm gonna play Confessions of Zuda Zuda right now. I actually really like Fencing School as a card. I think it's like the noob inside of me that loves sending it. But especially when I play like India, I hate having to build a barracks with your Agrafortis India, and so I have Fencing School in my deck specifically so I don't have to build a barracks with my H2 India. And I don't know. I think Fencing School is an underrated card. Now, I would not ever advocate sending it as your third card at 5 minutes and 25 seconds. I think that is extremely awkward. You don't have the economy to make use of it. You're not even going to be able to continually train units. But there is some merit to it, I think, as like a fifth or sixth card in Colonial Age, especially with long, drawn-out Colonial fights where you start to have a pretty good eco. You can actually make use of that train time. As your second card following three Warrior Priests, I don't know that that's true. One thing I'm curious about, I feel like I've heard this at some point. Does Fencing School maybe someone in chat notes, does Fencing School make Warrior Priests train more quickly?
That is a good question. Let's take a look at what
you're like
doing.
I feel like
they are hand infantry, so I actually think they should. I actually think that should be how it functions. And actually, maybe I mean, like, surely it must do, because why would you send it otherwise? It's not that good at the 5-minute mark.
Yeah,
I think that's a very valid point to bring up.
Yeah, I'm reading the chat now, and I'm trying to look. It does train them more quickly. Confirmed. It does train them more quickly. So that's pretty interesting. That's why he sent the Fencing School card, which starts to have it make more sense.
Considerably more sense, Well, there you go.
He's at 10 Warrior Priests right now, which actually is pretty insane.
Yeah, you think the speed at which he could now bust out villagers, or the difference they'll make using the War Dance, the XP that you could get rolling in off them. Not sure it's worth the investment, but certainly Germany, a civilization that is probably going to give you a little bit of time to... Well, having said that, considering the war, is that... And what you're doing right now.
Yeah, look at these guys just like healing each other up as well. He's actually done a pretty good job of controlling them, popping them in and out of the town center to make sure he keeps all of them alive. He still has all 10 of them alive. He hasn't managed to kill any of the cavern. Ooh, this could be really bad for him.
Yeah, that's a lot of villagers. All right, maybe it's not going to be too bad. Ooh, here comes the... Yeah, that's not healthy for Olans.
Yeah.
Wow, they just got shat on.
Oh, man.
Sit down, son.
At the same time, he is doing a little bit of a raid back here as well, so he should be okay.
Yeah.
But yeah, Puma's killing those very, very quickly. I'm not sure what kind of a position Aztec's in. I think Aztec's actually in a... Well, okay. German... German's aged up with a TP. Never mind. I was going to say, I think they're okay because he's like a 600 coin shipment away from being able to age up, and he's at 10 warrior priests, but at the same time, all of a sudden things are going to get much more difficult here.
Actually, never mind, he has a normal number of villages. I just saw 16 villages for King of Osmain and then realized, yeah. Oh yeah, Saddler Wagons count as two.
Yep.
So, never mind. Yeah, Germany up to the next age, Minutemen by the looks of it being called to force these back. Maybe he thought he'd just let ram his spears down his opponent's throat and just kill off the racks before anything came out. But it looks like 8 skirms has arrived. Take a look at the units in queue there. We do see war wagons in queue, all
right? Yeah, I think that's a okay unit to be making right now. I think it would also be just as good,
population
probably
traffic.
Yeah, I got it up. I realized it was off a little bit late. I think it would also be just as valid to just basically only train Cav from this point out. He did kill a fair number of Pumas. There are still a decent number remaining, a couple of these on top of this hunt. But if he just got enough Vet Ulans with that 8 skirm shipment in the back, he would probably be able to cut through the Puma numbers very, very quickly and then wouldn't really even need to worry about coyotes or Pumas. But his response... is going to be able to make a few war wagons to be able to deal with that front line a little bit more easily and then work his way forward from there. But it looks like Aztec doesn't have any intentions of aging, just going to be trying to get up a big number of units. Remember, he does have fencing school, and so his economy is pretty good. He's going to be able to get out a decent number of units very, very quickly. And as a result of that... he is actually going to have a pretty good army, catches a couple of Ulans here, has a pretty big army, and it's important to mention that he does have 10 warrior priests that are going to be able to be dancing away, I guess down to 8 now after the raids, but still has 8 warrior priests, which is fairly significant in terms of, you know, actually ramping up your DPS with Wardens, so that's kind of nice for him as well.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, certainly, you know, that number of, plus the villagers he's throwing on there, gonna be a real strong war dance. But the question is, how useful will that be with his colonial-aged units versus here? What is a growing mass of skirmishers, a quite frightening mass of Ulans that's, you know, also growing every time he receives a shipment, and 5 war wagons, which are now out. This is, you know, quite the Fortress Age army. I mean, there's a number of, I think Blue, you know, he's certainly... has more units than them at the moment.
Yeah, and this is a good time for him to be going as well, right? The veterancy upgrade for the Ulans isn't finished just yet. In fact, it's not even in queue. There's another shipment that still is probably on the way but isn't here yet. So if he can cut down this army size a little bit before that arrives, it's going to be pretty good for him. And this is a little bit scary, honestly, for Osmain. He's got to be very careful with this. Doesn't have Minutemen available. Trying to kite the Pumas as best as he can. And... hopefully there's a big shipment coming from him. Could be absolutely devastating if Cav come in the back here.
He could be toasted. Hold on. Do war wagons... I'm looking at their damage. It says it only does times 3 versus hand cavalry. Does it not affect coyote runners?
No, it does. I'm pretty sure it does.
It ought to.
Yeah.
Wow, he got...
It must do. Yeah. It doesn't explicitly say, but it must, right?
Yeah, I'm sure that would have been patched by now if it...
Yeah. Another big batch of war wagons is coming out, but he's still in kind of an awkward spot. I would assume 7 skirms is coming behind this. No, Black Rider's coming behind this. And these Mace Holton actually going to be a pretty good counter to all this. The Coyotes, the Puma's not super great against this, but he's got a decent Mace Holton mass behind this, and as a result, going to be able to poke his way on in here. And if he can keep up this pressure, he should be okay. At the same time... these Black Riders are going to be very difficult to deal with. The stable is still up. There is the chance that, you know, a couple Ulans just pops out of this and absolutely wrecks these Maces' day. But for the time being, they're doing a pretty good job of focusing down the range cavalry units and doing okay as a result of that.
Looks like a couple of Puma Spearmen coming up close to try and get their damage in, of course. They're going to kite them back. Doesn't want to. Going to take down the Aztec War Chief there. And deny the double XP. Mace Holton actually holding out surprisingly well against these strong units. I mean, that is to be expected, though, right? These do have times two versus this sort of style unit. But, it doesn't look like he's going to be able to be here much longer. Black Rider's a very strong unit. There's the Ulan you were mentioning, and they're now just going to come out and absolutely biblicize these...
the remaining Mace Holton. But the value of the Mace Holton there was very, very high. Look at the look at the Black Rider count, right? It starts out as 9. It's down to 5. There's 8 Ulans, unfortunately. Not going to be very good for him. But at the same time, behind this, Aztec's economic unit population is significantly ahead, 43 versus 30. He still does have the high count of War Priests back up to 10 at 43 villagers, which is really quite nice for him. Yeah. And he still has decent map control as well behind this. Plus, let's not forget, he did send Fencing School, so his ability to remass is actually going to be pretty good behind this.
Yeah, he did just drop 1,600 food and 1.2k gold onto something.
Did he? Oh, maybe he's sending big buttons.
Yeah, well, he dropped a substantial number of resources on something. We're about to find out, I guess.
Yeah,
take a look at text being researched.
Text being researched? Yeah. Oh, no, okay, he's aging.
Oh, okay, that'd be it. The warrior. So, going up to the Fortress Age. So that, he spent 1.2k food and 1,000 gold then, so I was wrong. Okay. But still a significant number of resources. Aging, though, at this point, right, is, how's that going to work out for him? Germany, looks like the Ulan Mass is back on the count from just one card and a batch. Maybe two batches. And without replenishing his units here, you mentioned that map control that he had. Gone.
Yeah, the map control is kind of gone, but at the same time... Okay, there's the veterancy upgrade for the Ulans. I was going to say, the veterancy upgrade still hasn't completed, and as a result of these Ulans aren't as strong as one may infer, but that's going to be changing here. Also, we have to remember, Aztec doesn't have their fast age available. They used it to get to the second age, which is going to be... quite impactful here, right? Because he's not going to be able to get aged up quickly, immediately start upgrading his units. Realistically, he would like to get the upgrades for his Mace Holton, probably his Coyotes and his Pumas as well. Maybe start getting, you know, some Eagle Runner Knights, things like that going for him. But because he's not able to do that, because he's got to age slowly, this is giving Germany a lot of time to remass, giving him that extra time he needs with that TP still up to get some more shipments out. And his next shipment could very easily be something like 3 war wagons or 7 skirms. And like you mentioned, every time you send a shipment, you get 3 Ulans with it as well. There comes 7 skirm. And this is a fairly difficult military mass for the Aztec player to deal with, who realistically, he still has to send a card, still has to get some unit upgrades. I just don't know if he's going to have enough time to be able to accomplish all those things as the German ball starts rolling into him.
Yeah, does get 3 Skull Knights out, though. Please don't notice them. I want to see it so bad.
Oh, man. Those Skull Knights, if they get up in combat with the Ulans, will just absolutely wreck
them. I love how they shadow tech as well every time you age up. It's pretty cool. Come on, get them in there.
He's trying. Haven't been picked off.
No, but... I reckon he'll notice them pretty soon.
Yeah.
Maybe not. Well, maybe we'll get in
there. Here we go.
3 more have just arrived, or 4 more actually have just arrived.
Oh, man.
Wow.
They're so brutal. These double
on steroids.
They're so brutal when they get in there. They still haven't been dealt with, and the Ulans have really no...
Yeah, I think Blue's going to clean this up.
Yeah, look at the
they
skull.
He just hasn't...
Oh, my word.
Oh, plus 15's everywhere. Having said that, though, I mean, yeah, the Cav are gone, but they're still infantry, and those are still skirmishes.
But this isn't bad for Aztec, right? He just killed all of the Ulans. He's down to 0 Skull Knights and just a couple Mace Holton, but at the same time, he's aged up. He's navigated his way through 8 Skirm, 9 Ulan, 9 Black Rider, 8 Skirm, and 7 Skirm. He's got his upgrades.
Crazy.
Yeah, he's got his upgrade for his Coyotes, and now he's got, you know, plenty of units out. I actually think he's probably still okay.
Yeah. Germany would have been so much better spot if he'd sniped the Skull Knights. You know, at that point, he'd have so many more Cav alive, right? And at that point, these Coyote runners wouldn't be quite as meaningful. It doesn't lose his Skirm Mesh, though, thankfully for him, and he's going to get back out of there, remass some more. Take a look at the villager graph. At this point in the game, I think that's suddenly going to become very, very relevant now that, almost has 20 more villagers than... Yeah. Is that just 10 more villagers than his... than his opponent. They're going to be able to produce units far more quickly. Of course, he also has 10 warrior priests dancing away, and those, of course, are going to provide a tremendous bonus to, of course, any fight that he is in. And, well, King of Osmain has resigned, and we get to see another match. Wonderful.
Yeah, that was actually a pretty good game. Optimus Prime quoting Aztec Garja's Aztec Guide. I don't think the Garja Aztec Guide says anything specifically. Doesn't say anything specifically about fencing school builds.
Hmm.
But I actually liked it. I think it was actually like a fairly interesting.
I liked it. It was interesting to watch. Yeah, it does make me wonder though what would have happened had he killed the Skull Knights a bit more quickly.
Yeah, realistically, had he been able to focus those down a little bit more keenly, he probably would have won the fight, because he did have a pretty good mass of Ulans there, and there wasn't a ton of anti-cav other than those 7 Skull Knights, but. I mean, it's not exactly trivial when he's just blitzing everything into you. You're backpedaling on top of your coin mine to be focusing those down, especially when there's a bunch of coyotes and stuff out in front of them, and you're getting closer and closer and closer to where you're gathering resources. The pressure starts to dial up more and more and more. So I honestly think that... It's a little bit more difficult than one would assume. Sure, if he could have gotten them isolated out a little bit more, or had a little bit more room to kite with his skirm mass, would have been a little bit better for him. But at the same time, maybe not the most trivial thing to do as well.
Yeah, true.
Let's do Siberia. Siberia can be fun.
Siberia makes long games.
King Wasman, good of idea. I think he wants to play Japan. Some guy just messaged me and said, "Oh, King of Osmain, pretty good. Oh, now he's behind." Referencing the Meister Kallen's old signature, which was absolutely classic. My favorite signature.
Oh, now he behind.
Oh, that. Now he behind, yeah. Wow, Sir Callan actually pretty good. Oh, now he behind. It's my favorite of all time.
Zuta Zuta's game?
I'm just trying to give him the map.
Oh.
I don't think I have... Oh, yeah, I do. I've had to find it. Have I told you about my neighbor's annoying dog before? Can you hear him? Can you hear him barking?
I can hear the dog.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. This is going to be the next Zuta complains. Go ahead.
Yeah. They've got... So, probably like 2 or 3 months ago, these people bought this dog. And this dog does nothing but bark. I don't know what they... like, if they just leave him at home, like in their apartment. I live in an apartment building, which is pretty small, right? And... I don't know if they just leave him home alone when they're not here, but whatever the case, this dog, all it does is bark. It barks 24/7, and it barks well into the night, like until like 1 o'clock in the morning. Every morning when I wake up, it's still barking. When I come home from work, it's still barking. On Saturdays when I'm sitting here trying to play video games, it's still barking. I don't know, how do you have a dog that barks that much and not ever do anything about it, right? Like, I don't know if they're just not home to like play with it or entertain it, or if they're there. Like, if I was there in that apartment with that dog barking, it would drive me bonkers, right? It drive you crazy, like, to be living in a small apartment and just have a dog barking 24/7?
Yeah, I actually own dogs, and when they started barking for no reason, I'd go and tell them to shut up.
Someone says, how does Suda not know that all you need to do is throw chocolate bars over their heads?
Can we get some Frank Aziz in the chat?
Is that one of... Oh, that's this one. Oh, my dog. That one's even better.
Oh, my dog. I don't think that's a public emote. Oh, it is. Okay. I've never seen that before.
I've never seen that.
I thought that was a subscriber emote of somebody. Because I've got a couple that you can't use, like...
That's a pretty good one. Oh, my dog.
All right, see, I've got this. Look at that. Look at that. Sick. Yeah. There you go. No kappa.
GG. Oh, what are these ones?
Yeah, I just told you. You can't have those. They're not...
Why not?
What happens? You have to... They're subscriber-only emotes. You have to subscribe to Zero Empires for those. Or you can... I'm subscribed to Total Biscuit as well. I subscribed for 1 month because I wanted to watch something in his past broadcasts, but I couldn't wait for it to go up on YouTube. And you can't watch his past broadcast unless you're subscribed for some reason, so I subscribed for a month and then I'm subscribed. My favorite is this one. I quite like this one.
59.
FPS.
I don't get it.
He's all about 60 FPS.
Okay. Oh, we're in game, by the way. We're ready.
All right.
But yeah, this dog is just, I don't know, like, I don't want to be the asshole that, like, reports him to, to the apartment owner or whatever, right? But at the same time, it's, like, so inconsiderate. I can't believe that they don't do anything about this dog.
I think you're well within your rights, too, if it's been going on for a while.
Yeah, it has.
I mean, if it was just, like, a day or two, then...
Yeah. Or if, like, I mean, I can understand you get a new dog, like, it's in a different environment, it's, like, scared, it doesn't know what the hell's going on, right? Like, the first time you leave it alone, it's probably going to bark like shit, but you would think that after some amount of time, the dog would get used to the fact that it's home alone, it would get used to the fact that it's not going to be there 24/7, stuff like that, and it would, like, calm the fuck down, but no, it doesn't. It just continues to, Oh, there's another one. Corgi Derp. I like that Oh My Dog one the best.
Oh my dog. I just called Bram an ugly dog in Dutch. So, recently, I'm the newest addition to the media team for ESOC.
Oh,
nice. But all of the pre-existing media team people, they all have one thing in common, and that's that they speak
Dutch.
Fluent Dutch. We're going to use some of the money raised for the Winter Championships to get me some Dutch lessons.
Get you some Dutch lessons.
We're not really going to do that with the money, but that, yeah.
Raccoon, there's a raccoon one as well. Rack attack.
Yeah. You never used to care very much about these, but these, like, you're now pretty okay with these. You're pretty happy with them.
They're pretty neat.
Yeah.
They help describe the situation so well. Especially that Oh My Dog one. That one exactly makes... It's like the exact situation I'm in right now.
There it is. All right, so from now on, we need Oh My Dogs and Frank Aziz in the chat every time that dog barks on the stream.
It's just going to be filled with only those emotes, because it just barks 24/7.
So... The dog is represented by Frank Aziz, and Zoo are complaining about the dog represented by the smoke.
Oh my
god. Zoo is just an angry smoke.
Cool cat.
Cool cat. So we're playing Hearthstone in Mandarin today. And the voice acting is hilarious, especially when you have someone with you who can translate it. So, and all of the cards have these really, really quite funny names. I wish I could quote a few. I think I will. So, the Boulder Fist Ogre is called the Stone Fist Enormous Giant Ogre. Or something. It's just such a really bad translation. It was hilarious.
And, are you ready?
What else? Sorceress Apprentice was, I think... like, trainee wizard or something. It was Let me think of some more. Oh, I can't think of any. That was great. Oh, Mana Worm was Magical Dragon Eel.
What? Optimus Prime is struggling to find that small red box once again.
This is the longest best of five I've ever seen.
Yeah. It's mostly because his Optimus Prime guy, like, he's taken, like, the Samwise breaks to a new level. He goes out and takes, like, a full-fledged 20-minute, like, break every time, after every game.
It's cool when Sam does it. But...
Are you ready?
Well, let's see whether or not... Let's see here, do you have any...
All right, can we make this a best of three? No. In five. Four, no.
We should do at least one more game.
Yeah, of course.
Where did he go?
Do you know what he is? He is late. That's what he is. Look at that. Sycamore.
Which one?
Late. This is the worst day.
Where are these? Who's Bodhi?
Oh, some RuneScape guy I watch. Yeah. Oh, not impressed.
What's this one? Some lady with a wrench.
Yeah.
What's that one from?
That's a public emote.
Oh, my dog barked back.
Bark back. Wake up, Optimus. He is a resident sleeper.
So what movie should we talk about now?
I got an update on the... I was going to... Let me scroll up. I got a whisper about the Lord of the Rings. Oh, it's gone. Never mind.
So Lord of the Rings. We've okay, so
let's recap. Lord of the Rings makes the nominee list. Game of Thrones.
Lord of the Rings, good. Hobbit, not so good.
Yeah.
Hangover, yeah, pretty good.
Top film.
Top film. Top. One of probably my favorite film of all times. The Hangover is a movie that I can watch any number of times. I could watch it three times in a row, and I think I would find it hilarious every single time.
Well,
do you have a movie like that? Do you have a movie that you've watched like 20 times that just like makes you smile every time you watch it? Everyone's got that one film, right? The film they watched when they were ill as a child or something like that.
It has to be something. I'm not sure. The thing is though, I just have this like irrational hatred of sitting down to watch a movie.
I see.
I just don't. It doesn't gel with me. I don't know, which is really odd because I'll happily watch a Twitch stream for 5 hours. They were both greened in for a fraction of a second.
Oh.
I haven't watched that many movies. Jim Lean has sent me a message. He says, could you tell people to follow the ESOC Twitter? Nope. Well, I guess I kind of have to now as part of the media team. Yeah, so yeah, Twitch... No, it's not. It's twitter.com/ESOCTV, I hope. Jim Lean will post it in the chat, providing links are not disabled in Zooter's chat,
yep.
Which they probably are, hopefully not.
I don't think they are.
Well, either way.
I don't know. I don't remember. But here we go. We're ready to start.
Ladies and gentlemen, spawning in the south of the map in the color green, we do have King of Osmain playing as Japan. Look at that, instantly, from the start of the game, going to be stunning that Snow Leopard. And I am being deafened by the game sounds again.
By the sounds.
Mm. Oh my goodness, keep take over.
Alright, well, King of Osmain, like you mentioned, in the south of the map, with 300 wood start playing the Japanese civilization, going to be dropping down his consulate nice and early, collecting up his wood. And collecting up that little wood treasure as well. His opponent, spawning in the upper left side of the map, playing the Indian civilization on Siberia, is going to be Optimus Prime. Looks like he's not going to be doing any shenanigans to start off the game. He did have the opportunity to do some sort of aggressive build. It was a 400 wood start for the Indian player, which does present him the opportunity, should he so choose, to build an aggressive 10-10 aggro fort, but it looks like instead going to be playing it economic to the max, taking a trading post at the start of the game, and we'll see how this ends up shaking out. I know this is something that like A's and Bonang like to do, taking this TP with the Indian civilization. It does slow you down significantly, of course. The Indian players do need a lot of wood to build the house, to build the trading post, and to build all their villagers. Wood gathers very slowly, so it does kind of slow you down, but gives you some nice economic benefits as well. So we'll see how that ends up shaking out, and whether or not you can keep up with the Japanese economy on this very, I would say, Japanese-favored map. Siberia, of course, the go-to home map for Japan.
We do, though, have a 50 wood treasure contention, though. Perhaps going to make back some of that wood, should he be able to pick that up, having spent it on the trading post. Looks like he's going to go in for it. Green, I think, got in there just a little bit quicker than him. Could have tried to go for the stun, but actually went to pick it up. But Green does pick up that treasure, 50 wood going to Japan. That's two-thirds of a shrine. And speaking of shrines, one is going to get laid down there. Let's take a look at what he has. Well, he hasn't said anything yet, and that's to be expected. We're not that far into the game. We do have a 90 wood treasure. It's a big treasure.
That's a really good one. And, I mean, this map is well known for its wood treasures. There are 90 wood treasures, 85, 50, and 40. There's four different kinds of wood treasure that can spawn, and as a result of that, there are just a ton of wood treasures in general that do spawn on this map, which in this matchup particularly is very, very important. Of course, wood treasure is very good for India to allow them to ease the burden of that villager creation. The early game allows them to collect a little bit more food early on, and starts them off on the right foot. For Japan, it just means more shrines earlier in the game, gets your early game economy really rolling. So very important treasures. Looks like the India player going to be able to pick up this 90 wood treasure with no contest, but at the same time, Optimus Prime picking up one of those little 40 wood treasures that we mentioned as well.
Yeah, Duba, just by the looks of it, is an absolute monster. Did you see how quickly those tigers got destroyed?
Yeah.
Yeah, it does have a x3 damage multiplier versus Treasure Guardians. Duba the Pet Monkey doing work. By the looks of it, we do have a 75 food treasure down here, which Red is going to come across. And if that shrine... No, it doesn't look like he's going to be starting that treasure, the green player there. So Red are going to come in here, but potentially something like that.
A contention.
75 food, though, certainly in the area, and worth picking up and worth bearing in mind. But so far... lots of treasures being picked up. Always so many on when it comes to Siberia. I think, actually, maps like this, like Siberia, ought to be, if you're listening, Gaia, I think future maps that have a lot of treasures that make casting in the early game a lot more fun, are nice.
Yeah, but as a player, though, like, it's kind of sketchy, right? Like, I love playing this map is Japan just because of the treasure specifically, but at the same time it makes it more difficult to balance as well, right? Like if one player gets 300 wood or something like that in treasures, it can be really difficult to make a comeback from.
Yeah, 300 wood can be like so much. Trading posts.
It's devastating.
Three steel traps, a number of things.
One thing I did want to mention, Optimus Prime has sent good faith agreements as his second card.
Oh, that's
so,
an interesting good.
Yeah, it looks like he's going to be doing something tech-based as a result of that. And I'm curious to see how it's going to end up playing out. Pretty standard-looking stuff on King of Osmane from the Japanese player so far. In fact, we can even see he's just building up his wall. He's playing very defensively. We've got the market... and the consulate starting to form this wall, and it looks like he's just going to have a full wall behind this as well. But at the same time, the India player is just TPing away behind this. He's playing incredibly economically aggressive. I think Optimus, or King of Osmane rather, was expecting Optimus to be playing a slightly different build, be playing more aggressively, but that's not the case. This is pure eco at this point in the game, and there is zero intentions of any aggression here out of Optimus Prime in the early portion of the game.
Yeah, going full eco there. Going back for that 75 food treasure as well. No monks in the area. It could be a little bit risky with the two deer, but actually going to clean them up very, very quickly and grab that food treasure. Optimus Prime is up to the next stage there, the Colonial Age, up with the the Kani Marti.
Yep.
So,
and that's going to expedite his gathering. If you take a look at all the resources that are immediately around this. It's actually in a really good spot. It's next to his berries, it's next to this coin mine, and it's next to this fairly large stand of trees. If you add on to the fact that he can probably herd this hunt into range of it as well, can maybe even herd this hunt into range of it, he's going to have a ton of resources over the next 5 to 10 minutes that he's going to be able to gather and powered off of this wonder. So a really nice economic boost for him. And combine that with the 3 TPs he already has. Let's see if he's getting Stagecoach. Not just yet, but I suspect at some point he may be able to pick that up as well. And could, as a result, you know, get a very, very strong economy. One that's even on par with Japan's at this point in the game.
Yeah, so what can Japan do to punish this then?
He can just tech it up, right? I mean, pretty smart adaptation from Osman. If you take a look at his barracks, he's got a single barracks. He hasn't even trained any units out of it, and I don't suspect we'll see him train any units out of it. If you see your opponent... And that's fine, too. I don't mind a couple of Ashgar. It's kind of like a 10-must semi-FF, right, playing the other way. You do want to contest these TPs as much as possible, and that's what he's going to do. Try and slow down your opponent a little bit. At the same time, you know, a couple sepoy out here harassing his shrines as well. He doesn't want to make too many units. He wants to get aged up probably fairly early on,
yeah,
and not overcommit on units too much. And it looks like that's what's eventually going to end up happening. He's got a good read on where these sepoys are. He can see them with his shrines. And so we'll probably see him train another 5 or so Ashies, but after that, should probably just be able to prioritize aging up and getting some sort of tech advantage behind this.
Yeah, it does feel pretty sad that at this moment in time he's not going to be able to make any use of the of the foreign logging? No, of the Good Faith Agreement. Sorry, that just arrived and distracted me. Good Faith Agreement is not going to be particularly useful here. No one underneath his town center. Going to be finishing up this shrine by the looks of it, which his monks have gotten fairly low. But we do have some conflict here. Musks are going to get back a little bit in range of those bestiaries, sort of lure them in perhaps. Does not get baited in, sees them with the trading post, and is perhaps now going to try and finish up this shrine before he heads on out of here. Is this worth it, though? That is the question. Does lose one sepoy, that's 100 resources. Does lose a second sepoy, or almost, but considering 5 more have arrived, perhaps now he can take this fight. I don't know, doesn't look like it.
Yeah, 5 more ash is coming. I think he's maybe zeroing in on the shrine a little bit too much. It's not really that important for him to kill it, and he doesn't. It's not really in his best interest to lose too many units here fighting, trying to get, you know, the last 10 HP on the shrine. The more important thing would be to try and fight to preserve the HP on the trading post, but I don't know if he's going to explicitly be able to do that either. But that said, is aging...
Ooh, painful.
Yeah, going to lose a couple more sepoy here. He is aging behind this, so, I mean, he's got a very strong economy. Has the 3 trading posts. Yeah, he's going to lose this one, but he did get one last pass. And economic unit population is 47 to 29, but that doesn't take into consideration, you know, the 8 or so vills that do come from these 2 remaining Stagecoach TPs and all of that stuff that goes with that as well. So economically, I actually think players probably about even. Japan's probably slightly ahead, and he's going to be able to pick up this shrine now as well. But I don't think that's too big of an issue for him here. And it looks like Japan gathering up his 600 coin shipment, going to be following his opponent up in the age.
Yeah, going to be heading on up to the next age. I'm really not sure what to expect from this.
Yeah.
He's going to, well, by the looks of it, you know, there we have Fortress Age coming out of the Optimus Prime there, but we knew he was going up. Japan can run down this trade route and slam down all of the posts there, should he take the time to do that. But maybe that's not what's on his mind now that he's up.
Yeah, this is kind of an interesting choice for him. He actually had a really insane economic start, did the Indian player. 3 TPs, got aged up.
Ooh, denies the stable.
930, that's pretty good, actually.
Is it worth sieging that? It's almost built.
Yeah, it doesn't want to overcommit, doesn't want to lose units at this point.
Yeah, that's a good.
Second barracks coming down for the Japanese player, and he does have the Golden Pavilion in construction as well. So we'll soon be joining his opponent in the next stage. And he did pick up that trading post that you mentioned as well. So starting to even that up a little bit. The thing that is very worrying here, we do have to look at the economic population. The Japan player sitting at a very healthy 200 shrine population. And very soon he's going to have dual racks up perhaps could be just going to be trying to age behind this once again. His economy is very, very strong. And despite the fact that, yeah, India has got a pretty good economy going for himself, Japan is in a league of his own at this point. Adding in a stable as well kind of tells me that he's going to be playing in the third age, and this mass for Japan is about to absolutely pop. He's going to have an absolutely huge military mass here in a very short amount of time.
It's going to get very big very quickly, and of course, Ashigaru Musketeers and Yumi Archers, those units can be upgraded once you reach the fortress stage, absolutely, and that is absolutely something that will happen. Seven Yorumi Swordsmen do come out for the India player, though I don't know how effective they're going to be. They can be really good when you pop them unexpectedly from a shipment spawn point on top of your opponent's army, but...
Difficulty here.
Flail elephants. Mahouts.
The difficulty with this composition, I mean, Yorumi Mahout is an incredibly strong composition if you can get it on top of their intended targets. The difficulty against Japan with that composition is getting it up on top of the Ashigaru because of their speed. It can be very difficult. Now, the bestiaries are in the group with the Yumi and the Ashigaru here, so this is a perhaps a chance for him just to ram it in here. I mean, if this just... Oh, man. Did he just really put it all into melee?
Unbelievable. He did.
Oh, no. That is a super dead army for Japan. That was a mistake. I can see why he wanted to put it into melee to deal with the Mahout, but putting it into melee to be able to just get up in the face of the army like that is... not advisable. And now all of a sudden Japan does have a very strong economy, but is it going to be strong enough to deal with this? We can see a bunch of walls starting to come up. We do have the two flaming arrows that have arrived, which are going to help, but at the same time, all of the sudden Japan is in a world of hurt. He does have Minutemen available. He's going to be throwing up a third Rax. We can see how important it's going to be for him to try and buy himself a little bit of time. Ooh. Does lose a couple of villagers, but...
He did not manage to get that wall up, did he?
Yeah,
and now
he
this does get a couple of units together, and of course going to call his Minutemen. A batch of guys arriving as well.
Yeah.
Is that inspiration? Yeah.
He's probably going to be okay. I mean, his economy's still good enough behind this. He has a Yumi and a Bestiaro actually shooting from the outside. A couple of the Yurumi are actually fairly low. They're actually still doing so much damage, though. He did call both of his Minutemen. He's got the one flaming arrow in the background that's going to be taken out by the Sepoy in hand combat. It's actually getting really close for him to be able to stabilize. He's kiting the Yurumi fairly well. The flaming arrow does go down, but I think he's going to have enough here. And yeah, here comes another big batch of units. Should have enough units to clean up this mess in his base. Unfortunately, his walling is just good enough here that the redcoat reinforcements are having a little difficulty finding their way in. So looks like he is going to be able to push back his opponent. Going to survive for the time being, but a very, very... poor choice for him to. I don't know why you would ever go into hand combat with Musketeers against your army.
Amongst all the chaos, he's somehow managed to find wood for two town centers as well, has the Japan player.
Yeah.
So looks like he's in a good spot to go into the rest of the game, considering he's managed to stabilize and get these resources down for that. Is that petards? It is. All right. Well,
where do we see the petards? Oh, they're in the group.
Yeah.
They're in the group.
They're grouped in with the sepoy and the redcoat.
Dude, petards do have six hand attack, so...
Whoa.
So, I mean, it's not, like, completely useless.
In Age of Empires 2, I believe you can task petards on units and they'll just walk up to them and explode.
Suicide bomber style.
Yeah, basically.
Well, I mean, petards are suicide bombers, I guess, anyways, right?
That's exactly what they are. But red here... I don't know, why is he getting back? I'd be okay with that.
Yeah, I think this is an okay...
Or is he waiting for a batch of units?
He's probably waiting for a batch of units, or maybe he's waiting for a little shipment. I actually kind of like this. Do petards one-shot shrines? If they do, this is actually kind of a neat use of them.
They exactly do. They have exactly the damage required for a one-shot.
That's kind of a neat use for it. I mean, obviously he would probably prefer to use it on something like a town center, or one of the wonders, something like that. But at the same time... if you can't get in there and you want to make use of them and have an impact with them right now... Oops, he just accidentally deleted one, I think. but, like I said, at the same time, it's probably actually okay for him to just be able to clean up some of these shrines around here as well. If you could, like, kill some of these type of shrines with petards, it clears up your next hunt location, stuff like that. So I think he's going to be okay with that. But looks like the Ashigaro's in hot pursuit. He does still have a single Yumi and a single Bestiro in that group as well, so it's kind of slowing him down a little bit. Realistically, he should probably take those two units out of the group so that he can catch up with us. But here we go. Another fight looking like it's about ready to break out. One of the Mahouts does go down. There are three here total. We have a Siege Elephant in the back as well. Not adding in too much. Yeah, he's kind of doing a little bit of a dance, wasn't he?
Yeah, he's spazzing out a bit. All right, well, that's not going to happen for the time being. I think Japan here, does he... Okay, he just sits back with his two TCs... Well, his three TCs, right?
Yeah.
And he slowly masses up units. He waits for the score to get ahead. He tries to maintain his shrine population and maybe do a bit of poking in here and there to see what the Indian player's up there up to and sort of respond accordingly. But at this point, he's in a good position, so just go ahead and...
Yeah, I mean, he can basically just make pure Ashigaro from here. He's got a very healthy economy, 64 economic unit population with 3 TC. He's going to be able to train a lot of villagers. He hasn't taken too much damage to his shrine population. He's still at 190 total, which is going to be something that he's going to be okay with. And pretty soon, yeah, poor elephant got assassinated. Pretty soon he's going to be in the situation where India is basically going to be starting to run out of food. And as long as he can keep the shrines up on the hunts that he's, you know, currently trying to contest, locations like this, as long as he can keep those hunts under control, the Indian player are going to start to slowly be starving out. And his massive Ashigaro are going to be able to just run around the map and do whatever they please.
Yeah. And big army now going to just turn up at the town center here. And, of course, Red's going to respond, but I don't know. There's a lot of green units there.
Yeah.
I don't think the Mahouts are going to add too much to this fight, considering, especially since one of them is very low hit points. Yeah. There it goes. He's just going to turn around there and, I think, just clean this up.
Yeah, and this is a fight that Japan is more than willing to take. He just sent Ashigaro attack as well, so his units are even more deceptively strong than they were previously. And India, truthfully, he has to have some Gurkhas here very, very soon, or he's not going to be able to just brute force his way through this with muskets. He's in danger of losing this town center. He's got about 20 villagers down here as well. Can't really afford to sacrifice this location with how much economy he has, but at the same time, Japan's army, very, very formidable down here to the north of the map. Does have two Hauda, and they're tanking quite a bit of damage with their 20% range resistance, but not going to matter. More Ashigaro showing up in the back of the fight. There are a few Gurkha here which are providing some extra DPS, but I think when all is said and done, when the dust settles, Japan's going to come out of this with an okay trade. And, well, at the same time, I mean, it's not
I think
it's not like the Gurkhas,
Yeah, those Gurkhas done some work. Yeah, it doesn't look too good. Plus, I guess the town center fire. He has got 10 villages there, actually 11. Can clean that up. He's going to chase the villages now at this point, make use of the extra speed. It's kind of funny.
Yeah, he might as well. He finally cut that last Bestiero out of his out of that control group, which was really bugging me because it was actually really starting to slow him down. But behind this, still a pretty good position for the Japanese player.
And the score just creeping up in the green player's favor here.
Yep.
Yeah, Red transitioning to rice paddies. That's not what he wants at this point.
Yeah, I'm actually surprised that he is transitioning to rice paddies because of two things. One, he's got the berries next to the carne mata, which he could still use realistically as a pretty good resource. And there's actually like a hunt right over here as well, which is still well within his realm of protection as well. So it seems a little bit strange to me that he would... not make use of those natural resources before transitioning over to rice paddies, but perhaps, well, maybe they're even just being used for coin, because at this point he's actually starting to run out of coin mines, which is something that I didn't really consider either.
Which player? Red.
Red, yeah. I mean, he's got the back little bit of coin there, and he's got, you know, 400 coin here. He's got 400 in each of those, and other than that, his coin mines are really starting to dry up in safe locations around the map, but...
Yeah, and green continuing to do a good job of being in lots of different places around the map. Having said that, though, these guys are taking a couple pop shots from the Gurkhas as they walk by. But Yeah, the score climbing steadily for green.
And this is going to be problematic as well, right? I mean, we've got Ashley's just running everywhere around the map, causing a diversion, killing villagers, if nothing else. And then behind this, the Shogun being pounded up. Pretty soon, King of Osman going to be in the Fourth Age. And then the window is going to be very small for Optimus Prime to make something happen. Because once the honored Ashigaru upgrade comes, yeah, he probably knows. Optimus Prime has resigned. GG called. And game number four, going over to King of Osmine in this best of five. He's going to take the best of five series and win the overall series 3-1.
That's right.
I am going to do a replay today. I've got one replay still to do in the queue. And,
all right. I guess I'll see you a bit later on then.
Yeah, we'll do some Hitler afterwards.
That sounds so bad.
We'll do a little Hitler afterwards. All right, I'll talk to you in a bit.
See ya.
All right, so King of Osmane taking that best of five series, 3-1. I apologize for some of the downtime that we had. But I am going to do a replay. We do have one that was submitted by Stefano Skirmish, so I wanted to make sure to get his game done. I also think he's a Japan player, if I do recall from reading a little bit earlier. So... it always makes me happy to watch young budding Japanese players as well. So let's take a uninstall a program, uninstall the UI so that we can see it. This guy. Come on, uninstall. There we go. Alright, got that done. Alright, so Stefano Skirmish says, "Hey, I've been focusing on playing Japan for the past few weeks. In my opinion, it's one of the most complicated but most rewarding and fun sims in the game. Pat on the back, I love that. Anyways, he's having some struggles against the well-played French. He has a recorded game and was wondering if you would have time to check it out and give me some advice. He's added 2 replays, and the first he gets beat, probably because he let him... build TPs and didn't fully shrine boom. Second's a rematch where he wins. I'm eager to see your opinions on these matches. Thanks in advance." I'm going to watch the one that you lose just because losses are easier to analyze than wins, just because in order to lose a game, you have to have done something very clearly wrong. Or usually you've done something fairly clearly wrong. So I'm going to do that one. And... let's see if... where is it? I put it in this folder. Oh, here we go. Alright. Put this in the right folder. My docs. My games. Witch of Empires 3. Save game. Put that in there. You didn't specify what patch you're playing on. I'm going to load up the... ES patch, and if it doesn't end up being on the ES patch, I'll just switch over. We'll do some Hitler afterwards, Zuzu 2016. Alright. So that's the preface for that, and we're going to be watching this game. Recorded game is invalid, probably because, let's take out some of these things that it's named. Let's remove some of the... my documents, my games, Age of Empires 3, save game, no! Undo, where did I just put it? Just dragged it into the wrong spot. Do this one. Do this one. Okay. Alright, so we're going to be watching a young budding Japanese player. by the name of Stefano Skirmish. Paused the game. Looks like he's playing Z Hansen 10, who is one of the guys that we watched last time. Alright, so let's take a look here. We're going to be watching Stefano. I would assume this is Stefano. Yep, Stefano Skirmish, the red player. Playing some Japan. The map is High Plains, Great Plains variant, and it is, as a Japanese player, one of the most rewarding things to see, a 300 wood start, which is absolutely great. So just to start out with, for a villager split, we want to be looking at three villagers on food, three villagers on wood, so that you can get that consulate started as quickly as possible. Try and split your villagers a little bit better on your wood crates so that you can get that consulate started as quickly as possible, but not the end of the world here so far. Alright, consulate. Alright, so, okay. Pause, timeout. We're gonna take a very we're gonna talk about very high level things with Japan first. With 300 wood start, I would almost always advocate for doing a consulate beginning, due to the fact that economically it's just going to set you off on the right foot. It's actually a pretty big map and a really good map for shrine booming, and against a French player who's likely going to be doing some sort of semi-FF build, or maybe he'll be playing aggressively. Either way, you want a pretty good shrine economy. You want to split him up on the map. So I'm not a big fan of this market start. I'll work with it to see what else we got, but I would advocate for doing consulate start in this matchup every single game, if possible. That being said, we'll see what else happens. Market start, not all bad. Villager production, pretty good. Nice treasure here. I would have tried to get that right away. Alright, so you've got this upgrade coming. You can get... civil servants here as well, which is actually okay. I would definitely get civil servants at this point. If you're going to do this market start, might as well commit to it. Japan doesn't have a lot to look at early game. I mean, it's gathering cherries, scouting, right? There's not a lot to comment on because you're just fire and forget, putting your villagers on cherries. This is a little bit awkward. Let's look at the placement here. This is a little bit awkward. You kind of block out this coin mine. I think you would be best off having your cherries be like here and here. You can definitely fit them in like this location so they're both in the backside. So you are going to be sending Heavenly Kami, but you're not Portuguese consulate booming. So that's a little awkward. I mean, two vills is equally awkward, probably more awkward. I'd also take out Onan War and put in 600 coin in your deck. The number of times you're going to need Onan War is very, very low. In fact, I can't remember the last 1v1 I played where I said, damn, I wish I had higher siege in my inventory. The only other thing that I think is worth mentioning in this build is you could have picked up Civil Servants with this build. I think would have made it slightly better. Civil Servants affects all resources, would allow you to chop a little bit more wood a little bit more quickly. Which would be kind of nice in the transition as well. Alright, lost unknown treasure. That happens. Happens to the best of us. Alright, Shuga Shrine going down. I'm not a big fan of this placement of the Shuga Shrine. Should be probably over here on the right side. Protects your cherries a little bit. And has a higher chance of picking up a large number of bison. Definitely do pick up the first wood gathering upgrade. With this variation of this build that you've done, there's no reason not to. That's the only merit I can see in this build currently, and so I would definitely do that. Have the wood upgrade, and I would have had civil servants as well. You would actually be gathering a pretty good chunk of wood here in the transition if you did have civil servants and water wheel both researched already, but you don't have them, so it's a little bit awkward. Obviously, you're just using up 18 more wood per shrine than you would in the traditional build, but you do have a slightly stronger villager economy going here with the market, so... I do think it's wrong, but the overall way that you've played it, I don't think it's been too bad just yet. This actually looks like it's a pretty long game. Alright, you have wood. Wood for a racks, maybe. That's what you're going to put down with it. 300 export. Like, this is... There's not a lot of rhyme or reason to this build that I can see so far. Is this a consulate? Okay, it is a consulate. I'm very curious what this is going to be. Because this is, like, non-standard Japanese play whatsoever. And I'm actually not hating it, which is something that's surprising me. Because the way you've actually played it so far is... Not the way that I would play in general, but I don't think it's actually horrible. Just, like, from seeing the setup that you have, the barracks, everything, like, the building placement, everything like that's actually been okay. You're at a serviceable shrine population. I'm curious to see what you're going to get here with this 300 export. Of course, building the consulate late here with the 300 export does give you the niceties of saving that extra 75 export from diplomatic intrigue as well, so... Maybe you, like, ally with Dutch here and get out the bank, which is, like, kind of a cute play. Five Ashy. Okay, so I'm curious to see how this develops, because Five Ashy doesn't really fit into this, from what I can understand. You're going for isolation. Okay, I'm gonna go off on a tangent here. This is completely a tangent that's maybe irrelevant, but I want to go on it, because I think it's kind of an interesting build. If you would have gone 300 export... Fourville, cut shrine population around 90, prioritized getting market upgrades, and done 300 export, Dutch consulate, gotten the bank, maybe gotten the batch of muskets that comes with it after the bank. You do have the little bit of coin trickle that comes from allying with Dutch as well, and then gone Fourville. You'd actually have a pretty good economy without shrines, without being so shrine dependent, and I actually... kind of like the build. Like, it actually gives me kind of a good idea for a build of my own. I don't think that this is inherently bad. It's not as reliant on shrines or the shrine placement. And I think it could be good. Now, here it looks like you're just going to be training Ashes and doing what? You're still gathering a lot of wood, which I think is not necessary with whatever you're going to be trying to do here. Make sure you train villagers. Not going to have, like, what are you going to put in, you have 700 export, you have to spend it in some way, like, right now. Bushido is wrong, maybe you're going to make shinobi, I guess that makes some sense. You're basically going to have 10 shinobi here with this build. I'm curious if this is the one that you win or this is the one you lose. Added, first you get beat, probably because you let him build TPs and didn't fully shrine boom. Rematch where I beat him with a three crazy... I wonder if this is the crazy 300 export scrap that we're seeing. I'm not convinced it's not. And just by seeing the length of this game, like, it makes me curious. Alright. Two trading posts. At the same time, he's making trading posts here as well. I don't think this is as good aggressively as it would be economically. I actually legitimately think this could be an okay build had these not been shinobi. Shinobi just feels so awkward here to me. That being said, I haven't seen... Okay, this is problematic, like these villagers being out here. I haven't seen anything that's overly... problematic. I mean, you're not training villagers right now. You've been penned up a little bit. I'm going to trim back the zones. A little bit. This is awkward, like, with your villagers going over here. It's a little bit late on your Minutemen call. Lost a couple villagers. Notice how awkward this, like, all of this has been awkward in your base. Let's pause and talk about that a little bit. This is probably, like, the first thing that, aside from... me just fundamentally not agreeing with your build, that I think you've done poorly. One, you had four villagers over here that got isolated out. Two of them, I believe, died as a result of being over there. And a lot of that comes down to this placement here. The overall placement of your buildings in your base isn't very good. And it's one of the most crucial aspects of playing a good Japanese is getting good building placement. The Shrine Wonder should be over here. The two Cherry Orchards should be here and here. And then you would have free reign over your coin mines. Here, though, you're blocking off the actual surface area for your coin mine. If you like see what we've got going on here, there's not a lot of room for villagers to pack in here. And so as a result, a couple of them got swung over here when this little area filled up. And then that makes raiding very easy for him. So clean up your building placement. The consulate and the barracks are okay. Arguably, I wouldn't put your barracks or whatever your first military building is quite that far out, especially outside of TC range. But it hasn't come back to bite you. But this placement has. The Tsushugu and the Cherry Orchard placement has come back to bite you. Got a fairly decent army. Shinobi, of course, do a surprising amount of siege attack. Helps control the TPs a little bit. Shrine population's not bad. One thing that I've noticed is you haven't gotten a ton of market upgrades, which is something that I think this build could accomplish. So make sure that if you are going to make a market and have it be an integral part of your early game, that you actually do get all of the market upgrades. Yeah, you're pretty low on vill count after that as well. A little bit of harassment here. Your scouting hasn't been great as well. You don't really know what's going on behind his base. That said, you've got him scouted out as basically going Moskos, which is great for you. You can make Pirashi from here. Make sure you're training units. You have plenty of resources to be training units here. Train units, train bills, you've got stuff. You're probably concentrating on this fight a little bit too much at this point. That just comes down to speed and multitasking. I don't love the fact that we're sending Ashy attack here. I would love to be seeing us send some four villager cards, but at the same time, it's not maybe too bad. Getting a lot of decent damage in here. Killed two CDBs, it's pretty good. Sloppy by him, that was really good there. Killed all those muskets. This feels really good for you. Control your units back to this side of the stable while you're sieging this, just to take as much little damage as possible from the town center fire. This feels like a win from Japan from here on out. There come your market upgrades. They're definitely late. You've had the resources to get those basically at any time. This is a win from here. Like, Japan doesn't lose this position. I'm going to pause it to show you how bad this looks from his position. Like, look at where he's at. He's at 17 bills. He's got most of them in his town center. His herding hasn't been great. He does have two... He has two TPs. That's not too big of a deal. He's short several hundred resources from aging. He's got 8 expos on the way, and he's just lost his stable. This is a win from Japan in probably 3 to 4 minutes time if you execute. So, one, it makes me nervous that this game is still got like 60 or 70% of it to go, because from here on out, Japan should win convincingly, is my opinion. Make sure, don't circle siege buildings. It's a good way to get yourself trapped. Like, see how when you're circle sieging here, like, this is an issue. We just saw, like, he's got 8 crossbows. He's popping out his villagers, right? He's creeping up his muskets. If we go back to you, you don't know quite as much of that because of your vision. But you look at how isolated some of your army is, right? These guys aren't going to be able to help in the fight whatsoever. You're basically going to be fighting with this army versus his vills, 8 crossbows, and these 5 muskets, which does lose, right? But if you had grouped everything up so that everything was standing right here, everything was standing right here, it would be a much more difficult angle for him to attack you from. You're overcommitting to this barracks. There you're finally going to start fighting. Make sure you focus down his military units. You have to kill these crossbows especially. It's very important that the shinobi are focusing on the crossbows or the muskets. either right now. But just hitting the villagers is very poor for you. Let's look at the hit points of his units here. Like, look at how many. All of these CDB have got like 20 or 30 HP off them, and in fact, he's already got the great coat upgrade for them as well. So, look at how much damage has been wasted on all of these villagers. That's quite significant when you've got pure ranged units. It's not wouldn't be as bad just to slam everything in there if you had a couple of cav here, but combined with the fact that you got isolated off onto the side, and then he brought in his CDB in a pretty impactful way, kind of crappy for you, but you did kill some CDB. I can see how you're not going to win immediately off the back of this, but it's fine. Should be training units. During all of this, if you kept up your unit production, you'd have tons more reinforcements coming. We're not training villagers as often as we'd like. In fact, let's look at the post game here very quickly. Oh, we can't. We'll look at the post game afterwards. And I'm pretty sure we're going to see that the villager production has not been great. This is also a position where I don't think we need to be sending cards like Daimyo Mototada. You can just be sending four vills here, improve your infrastructure, get a second Rax down, even send 600 wood, build some more shrines, and get a second Rax down. Just continue your economic progression from here. Start using your daimyo to train units here. I mean, you have enough. You literally have enough unit, enough resources to just immediately Q5 Yumi from your daimyo. And it's a mistake that you're just moving around and not doing that. Especially now, when like now with the Shia Bushido researching, you could get 10. You could get 10 Yumi out of this guy with your next shipment. Starting to look like you're going to try and contest the TPs, which is good. He's probably aging behind this fairly soon. Yeah, he's going to be ready to age. He's got Stagecoach. He's down to 14 CDB, which is actually pretty good for you. Pretty low eco game in general. Good. I probably would have killed the Explorer first. As long as he doesn't get away, it doesn't matter. Okay. You've got a ton of units here. You have to know he's aging at this point. It's very likely he's going to be aging at this point. Okay, this is a mistake. This is probably, you'd probably just like this card, but it's provides zero use here. 600 wood or 4 vill is absolutely a better thing to do. Or 600 coin. In fact, if you had 600 coin now, you could just follow him up and you'd be fine. This is just a flaw in your decision making. Like, that card doesn't belong even in your deck. It's not going to be useful. Alright, he's aged up, but you know his economy sucks. Not the end of the world. Your macro here is getting a little bit out of control. There comes a bunch of Yumi finally. You still have there we're finally starting to spend our resources. Not training villagers, yeah. You realize that you could unqueue a Nagi here or a Yumi and gotten that villager and queue a little bit earlier. I still think you're okay. Ooh, don't lose the daimyo. Probably want to wait for this. Well, you're still okay. I mean, honestly. Where's our cav? Get all this stuff rallied in. Because, like, this is... These units are especially the ones you need to be able to deal with as skirmishers. More cab, more villagers. His economy's still way behind. I'm still not a fan of the fact that you don't have 600 coin here, just because, like, this is... If you had 600 coin at any time, you could send it in age, but it's very awkward that you don't have it. It's a must-have card. I'm going to start speeding up, because, like, this game is won for you. I still don't know how this game continues to go any longer. You can just attack move underneath his town center right now, and you win. This should be the point where you look at the scores and you know that you're massively ahead from the military. The only thing that can lose you the game is if he gets out a ton of shipments because of his trading post economy that he's starting to build up. And, I mean, you just want to fight convincingly. Just march into his base and kill him. That's just a... Don't split up your stuff. Just get everything together here at the same time. Like, you kind of split up. Just ram everything right down the throat. We're all split up here. You see how all of your stuff is split up? Like, only like two of your units are actually attacking his units. You've got a bunch of stuff just randomly sieging here. You just need to get everything together. You've got tons of resources to spend. Haven't been spending resources very much. Look at how here again, like, you've just got half of your army, 10 units, just sieging away, not actually doing anything. If these actually were all just in this fight, focusing down the military units, like, you'd be crushing him. You've got another 10 Yumi coming. I'm still very uncertain about how this game goes this long, even though there's been some cause for concern here. You have the resources to age, you should be aging right now. Probably just don't... aren't practiced enough to be handling all of these different actions at this point. But the most important thing is to spend your resources. There comes the age. That's always going to be priority number one, is to spend your resources. I like that you've made a decent switch to Yumi here. It's pretty good. He's got to have like 10 CDB, right? Yeah, 9 CDB. It's not very many. All right. Lost the daimyo, got sniped, it's fine. Killed most of his stuff as a result. Doesn't matter. Chain units. You're still so far ahead here. Let's take a look at your age 3 cards. They're fine. Should probably be training a couple more Nagis just to be able to deal with these skirms. Oh no! Alright, just a little indecisive underneath his town center. You must have a bunch of units stockpiled somewhere. Is that true? No, it's not true. You're still fine, though. Like, 3 Corsairs with a 9 CDB economy is not ever any cause for worry. He literally doesn't have anywhere to hunt. He's fully reliant on TPs for food at this point. His next hunt is completely shrined up. Spend, spend, spend. Got lots of resources. Get those upgrades. Most important thing about getting to the next stage is to get those upgrades. Gotta get those upgrades. Gotta get the 10% upgrade, or the veterancy upgrades. So important. Close combat, good card. Oh no. Here come the upgrades. Ashi are so much safer than Yumi just for this reason. You don't ever have to worry about getting surprised by a bunch of Cav. You can also use Ashi just to hunt down skirms eventually. I thought you had a second Rax. No, you probably need a second Rax. You just need to be spending your resources. Look at how many resources you have. You have so many resources here that you need to spend. Gotta find a way to spend your resources. Okay, they're queued up a bunch of builds. You know, as horrible as this is going to say, I don't actually mind this for newer-ish players. At least you're going to have constant build production for this portion of the game, right? Which is something you haven't had very frequently this game. As long as you have the resources to do it and still be getting out big bashes of units, like, I'd rather see you train villagers, and if this is the way that you can accomplish that, that's fine. As you improve. Obviously, as your spending gets better and you're able to improve your macro, you won't want this many villagers in queue. Okay, Flintlock. Starting to control the TPs again. Royal Mint is fine. You're still so far ahead, it doesn't matter what you send. Japan doesn't lose to 9 CDB Ecopop. It's up to 15 again, but fact remains the same. Oh, you don't want to fight against those cannons. Just being a little sloppy. It looks like you just don't know how to end the game, really. Got a ton of resources to spend. Oh no, are you going to lose this game? Is this the game? I thought I had just gotten them switched around. That this is the game. You still win from here. You've got, look at how much resources you have. You have veterancy upgrade for your Yumi. Shit, throw down 3 more Raxes back here and just spam units. You're still fine. Oh no, I have a bad feeling that you just, you panic here and you end up losing. Yabusame coming, that's a good response to what he has. You have so many resources, just train so many Yumi right now. Yumi are your anti-cannon. You don't need these castles, that's a mistake, just delete them, push the delete key. Train Yumi. Yumi and those couple Yabusame are all you're going to need. Remember, behind this, you have 60 villagers. He has 19. Yeah, he's got 3 TPs, but whatever. You've got a TP too. Train Yumi. Train units. You've got so many resources. Spend them. Don't tip your hand that you've got Yabusame. Either that or run down and just kill the explosive cannon. I'm still not convinced you can lose this game. There's no way you can lose this game. He hasn't gathered a hunt for the last 10 minutes. Way of the Bow, good card. Looks like you're transitioning over to rice paddies, that's fine. Still so many resources. There we go, there's the Yumi. Train Yumi. Good unit. Especially with Way of the Bow. Oh, cut out of position, but it's not going to matter because Yumi are OP. Okay. Alright, so this, it looks like, was the game that you won. But here's what I have to say. First of all, I'm not convinced that your strategy is very good. I would prefer to see people who are learning to play the game stick to standard builds and master standard play. I've said it before and I'll say it again, standard play is standard for a reason, because it's been part of the meta for many, many years, and it's been tried and tested at every level of the game, and it becomes standard because it's just accepted as probably the strongest way to play. It's one of the strongest styles to play. For Japan, Portuguese Consulate with Shrine Booming is standard play. This was a non-standard build. It did some things that I actually think are kind of cute and are kind of interesting, but I would stick to mastering standard play and getting your macro down first before branching into creating strategies of your own. It's fine to create strategies of your own and stuff like that, but it's hard to judge your overall gameplay when you're playing completely non-standard. So I would realistically stick to playing tried and true builds until you're like PR30. And then if you want to become the next A's and do crazy stuff, have at it. Become the next great thing. But until you get to PR30, I would probably stick to pretty standard stuff. That's just an opinion. If you like playing the game your own way, like march to the beat of your own drum, that's fine. But I think you will improve more quickly by playing standard play, watching replays from standard play, and improving in that way. The most important thing that I'm going to say to you about this replay is twofold. One, let's look at the villager comb, because that was one thing that I was wondering about in the early portions of the game. And it is important to note these flat lines especially. Now, he had some flat lines as well. You killed a bunch of villagers, but during all of this early scrappy fighting, you need to be continuing to build villagers, because at this point you're at 20 villagers at 9 minutes and 30 seconds, which is unacceptable for Japan. That number needs to be like 33 or 34. you could be like way up here in Village Recon, right? Like you could be up here, and then the game would just be like absolutely be over. You'd have double his villager population. That said, at the end of the game, you got things in order a little bit, but this kind of breaky, like really shaky villager population is, I would say, at any level, is something that anyone should try and improve. The next thing to mention is spending your resources. You have to spend your resources. There were so many opportunities at like 12 minutes where you just had 2,000 resources that were unspent, could have been used in any number of ways. Seriously, at almost any level with Japan, if you just train Ashigaros with your extra resources, it's never going to be a bad decision. Even if he's making pure crossbow or pure skirm, you can almost always justify just slamming all your resources into Ashi. So if you don't know how to spend your resources, you're on the fence about what to do, what to make, make Ashis until it costs you a game, is what I'm going to say. And realistically, in this game, you could have just trained anything. Yumis, Ashis, Nagis, it wouldn't have mattered. You would have just had way more stuff. You would have won by the Zuzuda more stuff principle, honestly. You just would have had more stuff than he had. Wouldn't have mattered what it was. But you just didn't spend your resources. And even at the end of the game, when you have a 70, you know, villager economy, like, look at how many resources you have. You have 4,000 resources to spend and plenty of population space to spend it in. So, truthfully, you just have to spend your resources. Training villagers, spending resources. If you can do those two things, it's going to improve your gameplay tenfold. That's something that everyone really needs to do and really needs to practice. And I think it manifests itself well in this game. Composition-wise, I mean, not really much to say about that. You got caught out of position. Go back and watch some of the comments that I make about your army positioning, your building placement positioning. All of those things, you know, that I'm saying over the course of the commentary are important. But the two things that you really need to improve on are village production at all times, especially in the first 15 minutes of the game. There's never any reason to not have a villager training unless your opponent is all in underneath your town center actively trying to kill you. That's, I would say, the only acceptable time to not be training villagers is Japan. And two, to spend your resources. If you're going to play Japan, you're going to have a lot of resources on hand for a very large portion of the time. And as a result of that, I would definitely advocate making sure that you just spend your resources. Every 10 seconds, just look at your resources. If you have more than 500, figure out a way to spend them. The only acceptable time to have that many resources in bank is if you're saving to age. Truth be told, I don't think you're saving to age here. I think you have too many resources because you're just not spending them, or you're not comfortable spending them. So, Take those pieces of wisdom, try and improve your gameplay. Feel free to submit another replay. I'd be glad to take a look at it. A couple people in PR asking what PR this is. This is between the PR 20 and 23, I would say. So that's going to be it for SmackDown, guys. Thanks for tuning in. Hopefully Stefano watches this and finds it useful. And as always, thanks for tuning in. We're going to be playing Secret Hitler over on Interjections channel in just a little bit. For those of you who are interested about that game or interested to see what all the fuss is about, I encourage you to watch that. But otherwise, thanks for tuning in. SmackDown will, of course, continue on, even though the tournaments are no longer in play. And hopefully we'll see you next week. And hopefully I'll have my computer fixed as well. So thanks for tuning in. It's been a pleasure, as always. Until later, take care.